We've all seen war movies, like Saving Private Ryan, Men of Honor, and Pearl Harbor. All classic films. And we've actually seen what occurs behind the scenes of those films. But what we have yet to see is what actually happens behind closed doors of military families. I had a chance to catch up with one of my good friends, DJ, who just so happens to be an Army brat. And he gives his background of his military family, with his dad being an ex-airborne ranger. What you might hear next might be dramatic for you. I'm Jared Light, and this is the Home of the Brave.
I was born in Honolulu, Hawaii, on January 31st, 1991. I've moved about 12 different times in the past 20 years. It was hard, you know. I had a lot of friends. I went to like a lot of public schools, you know. They don't really have elementary schools on base, the place I went to at the time. But, it was pretty hard. You know, you meet kids that, you know, I've had friends that are been there since they were born, you know. And as you get older, it's like people that grew up together. Like when I went to high school here, you know, all these kids here grew up together. So, I mean, they kind of knew each other from middle school on to high school, or, you know, made each other freshman year. So, for instance, you know, freshman year, I got here my sophomore year from Hawaii. So when you're moving all the time, it's very hard to have close friends because of the fact that you're always moving. There's no really emotional connection to them. You know, you just met them. So even when I went to high school, you know, I only had a very few friends, you know. I had Jared, I had Vince, I had Joey. I mean, I had like maybe 3 or 4 close friends that I could honestly depend on out of a class of, you know, over 500 students in the entire school, as opposed to like the cliques, you know, the jocks, the, you know, the baseball players, you know, the ROTC kids. They've all been in class with each other since their freshman year. They all knew each other. They had such a variety of friends that I couldn't really get a hold of because people don't really know how it is for me. I don't get emotionally attached because when I moved so much, I didn't like to make friends because I knew that in the next 2 to 3 years, I'm moving again. You know, I'm going to have to go through the heartache, the pressure, and all this other stuff. I couldn't constantly think, oh, man, I just lost my best friends in my life, you know, and I had to go through that all the time. So when you're growing up in the military, you try your best to have friends, but you don't want to be close to them. So you always kind of have this feeling of being alone and things like that. And I think that's, you know, what every military kid usually feels growing up. Sometimes I live in one place for 1 year, some 2, some 3. I never lived in one place longer than 3 years my entire life. So, you know, there's a lot of places I didn't fit in at first, you know. One of the worst was El Paso, Texas. A lot of, you know, the Mexicans there didn't like the military. It was very much because it's all, you know, it's right on the border of Mexico. I mean, it's like literally you put one foot out and you're over the border. You know, that's where El Paso was like. And, you know, I mean, I feel the military kids used to get in fights all the time just because we were, you know, military. But it's not like we did anything to them. It wasn't like we said or did anything to them, but the fact that they didn't like military kids because their parents didn't like military because, you know, of whatever reason they had, they just didn't like us. So, I mean, it was, we all felt like outcasts. Mixed emotions, you know. I thought it was amazing, you know, thought it was cool having a dad that was, you know, a soldier saying, you know, my dad, you know, fights for people's rights. He goes out there every day to work. His only job is defending us, you know. And I felt a sense of pride with that, but at the same time, I felt a big sense of, you know, anger, I guess you could say, because I felt like it was affecting me because of his choices. You know, his choice to go in the military now affects me in the way I grow up because he had to choose to do this job, you know, and I think it was pretty hard, you know, to distinguish the two. I mean, I grew up, you know, in it, and it was pretty hard because I loved him for the fact that he did it, but I hated the fact that he had to be the one to do it, I guess. You know, in the end, it's like, it just goes both ways. Yeah, somebody has to do it, but at the same time, I'm thinking, why does it have to be my dad? Why do I have to suffer moving? Why do I have to suffer not having my friends? You know, why do I have to be the one who gets the payment in the end for it, you know? So, yeah, I guess it was just mixed emotions. It made him stronger in some areas and weaker in others. And then other times it'd be absolutely horrible. They would argue like any other family would, you know, and then be happy like any other family would. But there was times where, you know, he'd be gone, and the trust factor was one of the biggest things that came into play, you know. I don't know. You know, how would you... If you just put yourself in their shoes, I guess you could say, you know, you're gone for 3 months at a time, you know, doing training, whatever. So you're here for 3 months, and you're gone for 3 months. The trust between them was very, my dad to my mom was very short. I mean, she never did anything wrong, but it's just that, you know, it takes a mental toll on you. So when he would come back from training, he'd be very angry or anxious. You know, he'd look for things to get mad about. It didn't matter what it was. It could be a hat on the counter, I mean, a shoe at the front door. It didn't matter because he was just angry kind of that he wasn't around for the past 3 months. And so, I mean, that's where things were weak. But the love in the house was really strong, you know. We loved what he did, and he loved what he was doing. You know, we loved the person that he was, and he loved the job that he had chosen for his life to do, you know. I mean... Like I said, it was, you know, it was rough at times, and it was excellent at times. It's just like any other normal marriage. I mean, not normal, of course, military, you know, but they got through it. It's pretty hard, you know, being 13 years old and having your dad tell you pretty much that there's a chance you'll never see him again. It's pretty hard being my dad telling me that, there's a chance that I might be, you know, the man of the house, whatever. You know, at the age of 13, I had to start, you know, doing a part-time jobs over in Wahiwa, where I'm in Hawaii, where we were at. You know, most kids don't have to ever have a job until they're like 16, 17, 18 years old. You know, they're worry-free, their parents do everything. But no, I had to got paid under the table for working for a part-time restaurant there in the kitchen, you know, just cleaning dishes. So, did that dirt while going to high school, like, you know, middle school, you know, transferring it over. It was pretty rough on me. It wasn't easy, you know. And then he came back, and we put him for retirement, which we thought was going to be great, and he didn't get it, and he went to Afghanistan. And not just any place in Afghanistan, with the Baghdad. And we try not to watch the news for the most part, but I'd seen enough of it to know what happened in Baghdad. Now, this is like 2 years after the war began, so this is whenever, you know, the Saddam statue came down and everything else. And it was pretty rough. It was scary. There's nowhere left to fall. When you reach the bottom, it's now or never.